In the previous segment, we discussed how separation of variables helps us to solve three-dimensional problems in Cartesian coordinates. The harmonic oscillator was an interesting case, as it also displays a rotational symmetry. This is an example of a so-called central potential, just as the Coulomb potential. And for the Coulomb potential, separation in Cartesian coordinates fails. On the other hand, we know from classical mechanics that the rotational symmetry is useful, because it results in the conservation of angular momentum, which is defined as the cross product between position and momentum. We can exploit this, for instance, by writing Newton's equations of motion in spherical polar coordinates, so in terms of the radial distance r and the angles phi and theta. The position vector can then be written as shown. What you obtain in this way is a modified classical equation of motion, in which angular momentum appears via fictitious forces that can be written in terms of an effective potential. As you can see, this potential is proportional to the absolute value squared of angular momentum and inversely proportional to the squared radial distance. This modified motion is then effectively one-dimensional, just the sort of reduction that we found useful in the previous problems. Quantum mechanically, we indeed find that our problem simplifies significantly when we use spherical polar coordinates, and that angular momentum then appears naturally in the problem. We will develop this picture in two steps. First, we work through this relatively concretely in spherical polar coordinates. But this actually hides by how much our problem has simplified. It may well look more complicated at that point, so we will then revisit this immediately from the perspective of angular momentum being an observable. Well, our goal is to solve the stationary Schrödinger equation, where V is now a central potential, so only depends on the radial distance. So the only place where direction enters is in the Laplace operator, and our concrete and explicit approach starts by using its form in spherical polar coordinates. It's a bit lengthy, but we keep it manageable by dividing it into the so-called radial and angular parts. Now, this actually looks promising because all terms only contain derivatives involving one of the generalized coordinates, including the coordinate r that also appears in the central potential. And this implies that one can indeed separate the variables, in principle into three factors, but it is easier to do this again by just distinguishing the radial and angular parts, r and y. Next, we insert this into the Schrödinger equation. Now, by comparing the different parts, we find a condition so that the angular dependence in the last term factors out, which it must because the other terms do not have an explicit angular dependence. And when we look at this condition, then it simply states that y should be an eigenfunction of the angular part of the Laplace operator. These eigenfunctions appear in many three-dimensional problems, such as in electromagnetism, where one of their many applications is in the multiple expansion, so to define monopoles, dipoles, and so forth. These eigenfunctions are known as the spherical harmonics. They carry two indices, L and M, which in our context will turn into quantum numbers. L is the azimuthal quantum number, and M the magnetic quantum number. The symbol M clashes with mass, so we will try to make sure that the context is always clear. The azimuthal quantum number L fixes the eigenvalue of the angular Laplace operator. M is an extra index that takes two L plus 1 values running from minus L in integer steps to plus L. So there is a 2L plus 1 fold degeneracy in this eigenvalue problem. We will soon see how we can lift this degeneracy by magnetic field, hence the name magnetic quantum number. Finally, we give the explicit expressions for these spherical harmonics. As advertised, they factor into a part that depends on theta only, and another one that only depends on phi. The latter just looks like a plane wave, but given the meaning of phi, let's sort about the z-axis. We see why m must be an integer here, because otherwise we would have a problem when advancing this angle by 2 pi. The dependence on theta is quite a bit more complicated. It involves another set of orthogonal polynomials, the so-called Legendre polynomials, and their associated variants. They can be obtained as stated here. As I said, at this point this looks quite technical, but note that so far we have not made any contact to angular momentum. So to see where we are going, here are some observations. Firstly, now that we have determined the angular part, it will be fixed for all central potentials. The potential itself does not enter the equations for y, and neither does the energy E. Secondly, when we now insert this eigenvalue equation for y back into the Schrödinger equation, we can cancel y and remain with an effectively one-dimensional differential equation for the radial part r. This is the radial Schrödinger equation given here. This differs from the Schrödinger equation for a one-dimensional point particle in two ways. In the derivatives in the radial Laplace operator, which are a bit more complicated, and arguably much more interestingly, also in the potential energy, which has picked up an extra term. And if we compare this with the classical effective potential, this has exactly the same functional form. Indeed, we can equate both when we identify the terms in the numerator, so the quantum number L seems to signify the magnitude of angular momentum. Now that we recognize this, we can also look back at the Schrödinger equation in spherical polar coordinates and see that this term was already there and contained the angular part of the Laplace operator. This comparison suggests a few things. That we can interpret minus h y squared times this angular Laplace operator as an operator quantifying the total angular momentum. And I think it's fair to say astonishingly, that these values are enumerated by a discrete index L, so they are quantized. And in terms of solving our problem, the radial equation really only involves this quantum number L, so the technical details of the spherical harmonics don't seem to matter too much. For the determination of the energy levels, they do not matter at all. So we should probably think a bit more carefully how angular momentum behaves as an observable in quantum mechanics. That's what we will do next, and it will not only verify these suggestions, but provide us with a much simpler way to think about these features. Okay, then let's tackle this problem from the perspective of angular momentum. I here sketch the geometric interpretation of the cross product and write it out explicitly so that we see how it involves positions and momenta. To pass over to quantum mechanics, we have defined these operators already. In particular, we use the momentum operators to obtain the Laplacian, which is really the object that we are tackling at the moment. Also, we see that while the different terms involve products of positions and momenta, this never is into the same direction, so their order really does not matter. Hence, when we promote these quantities to operators, everything remains well defined. So with this, we can write down the explicit form of three operators, one each for each component of angular momentum. They are all Hermitian, so qualify as observables, and indeed turn out to be the physical observables for angular momentum. And what is really nice is that we managed to write them down in Cartesian coordinates, so can do all our calculations with them without needing to resort to spherical polar coordinates. But just to make contact to the technical results from before, we can of course rewrite them also with these other coordinates. And then we find that indeed the operator for total angular momentum, L squared, just gives us the angular part of the Laplace operator, including the factor minus h bar squared that we inferred before. Furthermore, one of the three components, Lz, takes a particularly simple form. It looks just like a momentum operator, but sort of for the circular motion about the z-axis. Now, this simply implies that the spherical harmonics are eigenfunctions of these two operators. For L squared, that was part of their definition. And for Lz, recall how the angular dependence of phi really just looks like a plane wave in phi, e to the I m phi, so the eigenvalue in there involves m. And therefore we conclude that the eigenvalues of both operators are quantized. So given our measurement postulate, observations of angular momentum return quantized values. The azimuthal quantum number L then relates to the observed value of total angular momentum, and the magnetic quantum number M to the value of the Z component. The spherical harmonics are not eigenfunctions of Lx and Ly, but that's simply to do with our choice of the coordinate system. Note that spherical coordinates treat the Z direction differently than the X and Y directions. In their form in Cartesian coordinates, all three operators look completely equivalent, and indeed Lx and Ly also have the same quantized eigenvalues, just with properly rotated eigenfunctions. In any case, this suggests that L squared and Lz are simultaneous observables, and we indeed find that their commutator vanishes. You can see this either by working out the effect on a function in Cartesian coordinates, or simpler, algebraically by using the known commutators between position and momentum operators. Furthermore, L squared also commutes with the other two components. However, importantly, any two components of angular momentum do not commute with each other. Their commutator is actually proportional to the third component. That's beautifully symmetric and an important result. Now, this means that there aren't any states in which more than one of the three components are well defined. And indeed, if you rotate the spherical harmonics to align them with the x or the y axis, they become superpositions of the original spherical harmonics aligned with the z axis. So they are no longer an eigenstate of Lz. With these observations, we can now hide the technical details of the spherical harmonics to a very large extent. What we do is simply to interpret them as the expansion coefficients of angular momentum eigenstates of L squared and Lz, and focus on these physical eigenstates themselves. So in Dirac notation, we would simply label these states by the indices L and M, which are quantized and constrained as before. And all that we really need to know about these states is the corresponding algebraic expressions of the eigenvalues. We can even do all our calculations in this way. The only other information we need are the commutators, so just everything in the red boxes. To illustrate how this suffices, let me describe how you can make observations on angular momentum in practice. This exploits that circulating charges create magnetic moments proportional to the angular momentum, and these can be detected by a magnetic field. What I write down here applies to weak magnetic fields, which do not themselves have a large effect on the orbital motion itself, so this is really in the spirit of perturbation theory. Now, if our system has a central potential and we align the z direction with the magnetic field, then classically the z component of angular momentum is conserved, as the problem remains rotationally symmetric about this axis, even though the magnetic field removes the rotational symmetry about the other axis. quantum mechanically by just proceeding algebraically and using the eigenvalue equations of the operators, we see that the eigenstates are just the ones we had before, and the only thing that changes are the energies, and they now depend on the magnetic quantum number m. So for any value of L, we get two L plus one distinct levels. The degeneracy has been lifted. Their spacing is uniform and proportional to the magnetic field with a factor that involves fundamental constants. This is known as the Bohr magneton. I will come back to this a bit later for the hydrogen atom, where this picture translates into the so-called Zeeman effect. Now you can set up an apparatus that goes one step further and physically separates particles depending on this potential energy. This is the Stern-Gerlach experiment, where you simply shape the magnets so that the magnetic field strength varies along the direction of the magnetic field. So the potential energy now has a gradient and hence results in a force, and this depends on the magnetic quantum number m. Therefore, when you collect the particles on a screen, you should observe two L plus one spots. That's always an odd number. Hence, that's another way to measure angular momentum, specifically one component of it, namely the one aligned with the magnetic field. It actually becomes quite interesting when you consider measurements with several such apparatuses placed in sequence, measuring different components. This really helps to illustrate the concept of incompatible observables, such as Lx, Y, and Z. But we will do this a little bit later for a simpler case involving spin. Because here's a surprising fact. If you carry out this Stern-Gerlach experiment with silver atoms, you find just two spots at about twice the spacing you would have expected. So something seems to be missing. It could be that sometimes all even values of m are forbidden. Then we would need a mechanism for this, and we will later learn about selection rules where additional constraints are placed on observable processes. Also, some further restrictions will appear when we look at systems composed of more than one particle, and atoms are one good example of this. But here it turns out that the resolution is different. It actually has two ingredients, with the for us most important one being the following. Particles can carry their own intrinsic angular momentum, independent of their orbital motion, and these can correspond to half-integer values of L, that's to say an integer plus 1/2. In particular, taking the relation between the number of spots and L literally, two spots correspond to L equals to 1/2. And that's the value that you find for the intrinsic angular momentum of an electron, but also for other particles such as protons and neutrons. This intrinsic angular momentum is known as spin. The other ingredient is an extra factor of 2 in the magnetic moment generated by this spin, which is of a relativistic origin and turns out to be not even exactly 2 if you carry on to a more precise theory of electrons and light, quantum electrodynamics, where this extra factor is just a tiny little bit larger than 2. For our discussion, we take this extra factor as given. It can really be interpreted as a characteristic constant that can be derived in a more sophisticated approach. Instead, we will focus on the quantum nature of this additional spin degree of freedom, which has a wide range of applications. As we will see, it is actually quite easy to formulate the quantum mechanics of spin. We simply apply our postulates in a quite natural way, and then end up with the really most simplest quantum system there is.